Welcome, readers. Today on Book Chat, we are breaking down the February buddy read, Razorblade Tears, written by S.A. Cosby. Stay tuned. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Amazon Music. Check it out. It has 70 million songs, thousands of playlists. You can listen without commercials. Sign up today and get your first month for free using the Shelf Addiction link. Go to getamazonmusic.com/shelfaddiction and sign up today. Again, the code is shelfaddiction. The link is also in the show notes. Hey everyone, I am your host, Tamara Ford, and thank you for downloading this month's Buddy Read discussion featured here on the Shelf Addiction Podcast. If you're new here, every week we get bookish with book discussions, book reviews, shelf bites, and more. If you're wondering what is a Buddy Read, this is a feature where Classy and I select a thriller or mystery title that we both are interested in. Then we have a candid conversation about that book or audiobook. We even discuss it in our Facebook group, Shelf Addiction Official, during a live chat. So grab a glass of wine, a cocktail, a cup of tea or coffee, whatever your drink of choice is, and settle in for this fun discussion. As always with book chats, there is a spoiler alert in effect, so you've been warned. If you enjoyed today's episode, please support this podcast by sharing it with your book nerd friends or on your favorite social media space. That will really help me out, and I appreciate you for doing it. The uncut video version of this podcast is available now on Patreon. Join us there for exclusive videos, including this podcast after show. If you'd like to support the show in other ways, please consider doing that by supporting our sponsors. By supporting them, you are supporting us. Check out all of the sponsors at shelfaddiction.com/sponsors. If you've read the book or listened to the audiobook and would like to weigh in on this conversation, be sure to join the Facebook group Shelf Addiction Official. I hope to hear your thoughts on this discussion. Links for everything I've mentioned are in the show notes, so let's get going. We've got a lot to cover today, so we are going to jump right on in. Joining me is the Buddy Read feature co-host, Classy Green from The Bookish Virtual Assistant. Welcome back, Classy.
Hey, hey, Tamara. How you doing tonight?
I'm doing wonderful. How about yourself?
You know what? I think I'm doing pretty wonderful, too. I thought about it. I'm like, I don't have any complaints today, except we're going to get a lot of snow, but other than that, too.
Like, the schools have already started, like, saying they're closed tomorrow. Yep. Has that happened your way, too?
Probably with the schools. I haven't really watched the news, but, like, the sanitation and snow plows, the city has already sent out letters, like, we're going to start picking up garbage at 5:30 in the morning.
Oh,
and
man.
Some other things may be delayed, so I'm just waiting.
So, you know, lately we don't do a lot of cooking in this house, or I don't, because I'm the only one that cooks. But yeah. I'm like, well, I don't think we have a lot of food in the house. So yesterday I went to the grocery store because, you know, I'm not going out to pick up salads or whatever. So I'm like, well, we gonna have some food in this house for the next couple days.
Yep, exactly.
And my home chef delivery came, so we're good for at least 3 days. But I think it should be over by then. Thursday, mid-Thursday, it'll be over.
Yeah, same here. I had shopped Sunday and did a couple meals. So after that, you're on your own, bruh.
Stand for yourself.
Did That's my what life I like to duties. Call it. And, right. Yeah.
There's just no more enough children so you don't die. House. Beyond that.
Thank you. Hey, we have cereal, milk,
yep.
Eggs, bread.
There you go. Bam. See? We even have tortilla chips and salsa and popcorn.
See? And I bet you there's some wine in there. You have a meal.
Yeah, exactly. Popcorn and wine. That's the perfect meal.
Y'all strengthened.
I know.
You got the winter storm covered.
Yes, we're good. So I guess we should share because, you know, today we have like a really like raw, gritty kind of book. And one of the people in the book is like an alcoholic. So, you know, I decided to or Classy started it. And then I'm like, I'll get some, too.
Hey, I'm just following, you know, like the lead from the book.
Yeah, that's what we're doing. And it's perfect. It's fitting. We both have bourbon.
Yes.
And I feel like all refined and old with my bourbon. Older.
Yes.
So I'm not old.
There you go. I'm seasoned. I don't know about you.
Seasoned. Okay. Yeah, I like I'm that seasoned. One.
Yes. The bourbon, okay. This is grown folks. This
yes, it's grown
folks drink.
For the grown and sexy, as they say.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yes. And so we're going to dive right into the book stuff. So if you hear a little jingling or ting, it's the ice in my glass.
Love
don't
it.
Worry, y'all. We got water. We have water on deck so things won't get out of control. So it's good. It's good. We're going to have a good time today. So grab your drink and let's do it.
Yes.
All right. So, of course, as always, if you want to head on over to today's after show, it's available right now on Patreon. We're talking about some interesting stuff that has come up over on Book Talk. So that will be some entertaining conversation. And so you don't want to miss out. Go on over and check that out right now. So today we are discussing Razorblade Tears, written by S.A. Cosby. Narrated by Adam Lazar White. First published July 6, 2021 by Flatiron Books and Macmillan Audio, respectively. The hardcover comes in at 336 pages. The unabridged audio comes in at 12 hours. That's a lot. We'll get into why that's a lot a little later when we talk about the narrator. Classy, would you kindly share the synopsis?
Absolutely. A Black father, a white father, two murdered sons, and a quest for vengeance. Ike Randolph has been out of jail 15 years, with not so much as a speeding ticket in all that time. But a Black man with cops at the door knows to be afraid. The last thing he expects to hear is that his son Isaiah has been murdered, along with Isaiah's white husband, Derek. Ike had never fully accepted his son, but is devastated by his loss. Derek's father, Buddy Lee, was almost as ashamed of Derek for being gay as Derek was ashamed of his father being a criminal. Buddy Lee still has contacts in the underworld, though, and he wants to know who killed his boy. Ike and Buddy Lee, two ex-cons with little else in common other than a criminal past and a love for their dead sons, band together in their desperate desire for revenge. In their quest to do better for their sons in death than they did in life, hardened men like Ike and Buddy Lee will confront their own prejudices about their sons and each other as they rain down vengeance upon those who hurt their boys. This is, they said it's provocative and fast-paced. It's a story of bloody retribution, heartfelt change, and maybe even redemption.
Oh,
yeah. Say it's a befitting synopsis.
It is bloody.
Oh. It's crime fiction. And
right.
Yes.
And so for those very sensitive to gritty stories, trigger alerts, trigger warnings for homophobic, racist, sexist language.
Yes.
Murder.
Lots of murder.
Kidnapping. And I think that's it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, yes. There's a lot going on. But, you know, if you're sensitive to that, just a heads up. Okay. Where shall we start, Classy?
Look at my notes here.
Because this is like so much. We're like, let's defer to the notes.
Yes. Because, I mean, it is. Yeah. It's just so much. And as far as, you know, because sometimes we go like, okay, let's do a high level over the synopsis. But that synopsis was...
It was very good.
It was perfect. I mean, I think where we can go from here is, you know, the two boys were murdered. It was a double murder. They were murdered, you know, at the same time. Buddy Lee and Ike meet each other at the funeral of their sons. And Buddy Lee just kind of happens to notice a prison tat on Ike's hand. And he realizes that prison tat means something. It means he's got a body count.
Yeah.
And kind of told him, hey, why don't you get rid of it? And I think at that point, I don't know about you, I think that was at the point where Buddy Lee was like, maybe we should. I think I found a partner, you know, because Buddy Lee, like the synopsis says, Buddy Lee has some connections to the underworld.
He's been to jail.
Yeah, he's been to jail. He's a good old, well, I won't say a good old boy, but I know in the book they describe him as a redneck with a blue collar. So, you know, he kind of, you know, I know.
He's like, okay, so Buddy Lee is like, right, he's that guy that's right on the edge. Like, you're racist, but you don't want to be racist. Like, you're racist and you don't know it.
Yeah. Like, my grandfather talked like this all the time. They didn't mean no harm.
Right. Yeah. So he teeing and ha-ha with everybody else.
Yeah. And but Lee is that one that likes to say, your kind or you people.
You people.
You what people are you referring to?
Yeah, and your kind, like, dude. And you know what? Ike was about to yank his head off. He's about to knock his head off. Ooh. Like, you're not going to say that again. You got one.
No, this one more time.
It's one.
Yeah. And I did like that about Ike. He was like, you got one more time, or you need to lower that bass. You need. Yeah. He was like, mm-mm. And that's the other thing. Like, Ike, like the synopsis says, he had been out of jail for 15 years, living an upstanding life, an upstanding citizen. He's a business owner. He owns his own landscaping company. You know, he's trying to, you know, he's reformed. And, you know, and now his son dies. And here comes Buddy Lee, who is, okay, I'm just going to say, he's trailer trash. And I mean, the story says, you know, I'm not saying this to be derogatory. In the story, he lives in a trailer.
Literally,
he even calls himself basically trailer trash. And, you know, these two men, their sons are gay. Neither one of them accepted that their sons were gay. And now that their sons are dead, I think they are beginning to, they are regretting that they never had the opportunity to love their sons regardless of their sexuality. And now they know, I mean, the story, okay, let me go back a little bit. The story is set in Virginia, Southern Virginia. I can't remember the exact city, if it was mentioned, but you know, it's a southern state with a lot of
it's rural. They talk about the roads not having Wi-Fi or signal
right
for the phones, so it's rural, definitely,
right? And even in S.A. Cosby's other book, he likes to talk about the backwoods and how racist they are and how they have all these views on gays, just backwoods, caveman, knuckle dragging views on different things. And these two men, both of them hypersexual males who, hypersexual males and gay boys is probably a hard pill to swallow. But now these two boys are dead, and now they don't have a chance to rekindle or repair that relationship. And they know in that city or that state that the police possibly are not going to delve into who killed their sons, not fully. I mean, if you think, Ike is a Black man who's been in jail, so he knows. You guys probably aren't even going to, you don't even look for the murders of Black men, let alone a gay Black man.
Yeah.
Then, two gay men. So,
but in this case, though, he did a little bit different twist on the police, though. It's not like the police were like, F it, we're not doing anything. It really started because none of their so-called friends or co-workers or anything would say a word. They were all mouth shut.
Yeah, you're right. They kept their, because of I believe what you believe because of some of the connection with the person who possibly killed the sons, and because they were high powered.
Yeah. So the people at the paper that Derek worked for, I think it was Derek that worked for the paper, right? The
Isaiah did. Derek
Isaiah
was
worked for the paper.
Chef or,
yeah,
or
he was a
baker
chef.
Or something.
Mm-hmm. Something. So the paper people didn't want to say anything because, you know, that community, they don't like it when the police are around.
Right.
The girl, Tangerine, who we'll talk about later, had some firsthand knowledge, but she didn't want to out of fear.
Mm-hmm.
Some, I think they approached somebody else. So they basically played CSI, I guess.
Yeah.
They went, started asking questions. You know, these two old dudes, these old heads, nobody, what they gonna do? Nothing.
Right.
Until... until
they didn't realize the background. But they also felt like, you know, these people in this community won't talk to the police, but they possibly will talk to us because we're their fathers. But
right.
They were met with some resistance because
they
knew that these fathers did not accept their sons. They're like, oh, now that they're dead, now you want to act like you cared.
Mm-hmm.
Or you act like you
which
care.
Is true. That's what they what that's what happened. They didn't care until they were dead.
Yeah.
And then it was regret that regret and revenge fueled this whole book.
Yeah, it did. And then it did. And in the end, I think that did fuel it. But it also throughout the trajectory of the story, it also caused their eyes to be open to love and what love really is. And that love was not even seen just because between, you know, the two males, but the relationship between Buddy Lee and Ike. And I think I'm going a little further, you know,
yeah,
you know, going a little past what you're talking about, but yeah, it was fueled by revenge and it was fast too.
Yeah.
That revenge was like, let's go.
Yeah. So that kind of leads me into wanting to talk about like the pace of the book. Like everything pretty much happened pretty quickly. Even the time frame of the actual events going on were quick. Like it felt like it was like maybe a week, maybe, if that.
Yeah. Yeah.
And because of that, yeah, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, I think you're right, because it went from the funeral to the cemetery calling, saying, hey, the headstones. So it had to be maybe a month. If I'm going timeline according to how long it takes for a headstone to be placed on top of a grave. But it probably was sooner according to the book, but I'm just, you know what I mean? Mm. It takes more than some weeks before headstones are
placed.
Well,
at least a week from the time that Buddy Lee and Ike decided to do what they're doing.
Okay, I see what you're saying. I was going from the time when, because at first, Ike was not on board with revenge. Because he's just like, who are you? Why are you in my face? I don't know you. I probably don't like you. I see you, you know, and you know, I kept kind of picking at him. And once the cemetery called and said that their headstones were vandalized, then, but I decided, you know what? I think I'm going to join Ike in finding out who killed our sons, because this is just wrong. And the police probably are not going to do it. It's a vindictive. It's more to this story than meets the eye. But yeah, you're right. Probably once they did decide to mount up or join forces.
Could you hear Warren G regulators in the background?
I did. Regulators. Mount up. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. But yeah, you're right. Probably once that happened, it was quick, fast, in a hurry, and at first I was like amazed at these two old farts figuring it out. But then it started hitting me again. Okay, they're criminals. They know how this goes, you know. And I think too, because I was just so focused on Ike being a businessman. But, you know, because we knew he served time and he had some bodies, but we didn't know the full story of how he got there. And once they kind of talked about that story, I'm like, oh.
Like, Ike killed a lot of people.
Ike's name was Riot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He kills a lot of people. He he is an expert at just getting rid of the bodies, which he demonstrated in the book.
Mm-hmm.
Like riding a bike.
Yeah. It was kind of like, I'm trying to keep this down. I don't want him to come. I do not want Riot to come out.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remain them. Ike.
Yes. It's funny because that one scene where he gets rid of the body, this body, Buddy Lee comes later. He's like, oh my God, is the body in there? The body's in there. He's like, he just couldn't really understand how serious Ike was. I think that was the moment he was like, oh, dang, you're like that. Okay.
I knew he was like that when he took that tamper. That part right there, I don't know about you, Tamara, but when he took that tamper, and you guys, a tamper is a piece of equipment that they use in landscaping to tamp down, you know, all the, you know, the soil or whatever to make it flat. And he killed a man with that tamper to the point where that man's face probably was not even recognizable.
No, closed casket.
No, yes. And I think he did that because, was it his son or was it Isaiah or was it Derek who's, they had to have closed caskets because
they were shot in the head.
Yeah.
In the face a couple times.
Yeah. The morticians could not repair their faces to be presentable. And I think it all just came back to him like, okay, you mofos did this to my child. Because I mean, it was like nonstop to the point where Buddy Lee was like, okay, dude, you can stop. He's dead.
Yeah.
He just blanked out. But
like, I think he's dead. You can stop.
Yes. And S.A. Cosby does not pull any punches, guys, when he talks about the gruesomeness of these murders. If you have a weak stomach, I guess have a weak stomach.
Yeah.
Or you're not into, be ready.
Okay. So if this was a movie, think of the most graphic movie you can think of. Like, there is no cutaway scene. You're seeing this thing come down on that person's head.
Yep.
There's no cut, fade away and look at the splash of blood on the wall. You're actually going to see it.
Pulp Fiction.
Yeah.
Straight Pulp Fiction.
Right.
And I was here for it. I'm sorry. Yeah. Okay. I was here for it. At first I was like, OMG, because I wasn't ready.
Yeah.
But once I was ready, once, you know, I got through that, I was like, okay, all right, this is what you're doing, essay. Okay. I'm ready.
I mean, if you're going to do it, do it. And he did. He was like, well, why sugarcoat it?
Right. I have opened up the gates.
Yeah.
Welcome to my world.
Right.
Yeah.
Yikes.
Mm-mm. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, but, gosh.
I know. It was a lot. But, the plot of it was action packed. It was like you said, after a week, it was action packed. It was just constant. But I would say it was action packed, but it was like ebbs and flows. I don't know if you felt that way. Like he would give us like a bam, 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 and then he'd drop it. And then all of a sudden he, you know, up again and drop it. But it was never, I felt like it dragged.
Yeah, I think some of those interludes were a little wordy, but I think they kind of needed to be because some of them were like teachable moments for the reader or something like, hey, in case you're one of these people, hey, don't do this. Don't do that. Don't say this.
Yes.
Like, yeah. So it made sense, even though it did get a little wordy at times. It fit still.
Yeah. And I think that kind of goes with the noir, because this is kind of that noir fiction genre where it's kind of dark and moody and all that. And there were a lot of teachable moments, a lot of euphemisms, which I enjoy because they were funny as hell to me, you know, because I just think of, I have a, you know, some of my family are from the South and I was like, oh, I know a lot of these old slang terms, you know, and they were fun. But, and I did read somebody's review where they felt like some of his teachable moments were over the top. And at first I was like, okay, I kind of see what they were doing, but I also felt like
Ask you a question. What person wrote the review?
It was Roxane Gay.
Okay. She said they were over the top, huh?
She thought some of the LGBTQ stereotypes and, how they reacted was over the top. And she is a member of the LGBTQ community as well. Yeah. And at first I felt like they were over the top when I read that. But then I was like, I think what he was trying to do in this book was put a spotlight on how people really feel. And I mean, we know they feel like that, but it was kind of like, here we have these two hypersexual men. And I don't know. I mean, there probably are some books out there. I haven't come across it where you talk or they're talking about fathers of gay men who are dealing with this and how, because you had the scene where the one guy either touched his arm or offered him a drink and he just snapped. And at first you're just like, oh. But that happens all the time. I mean, you think about some murder cases out here where people find out.
Uh-huh. Well, I don't think that was over the top. That happens.
Yeah. But I think he was trying to put a spotlight on this is how some men feel, because I tried to teach them how to box and I tried to do this and they just never accepted it. And, I almost felt like I had a glimpse into the world of men because so many times we don't know how men feel about topics.
Even the scene when they were, when Ike was at the barbershop, this is how they talk in the barbershop.
Mm-hmm.
This is what they joke about.
Yep.
This is how they feel about it, even if they don't feel it. Inside, outwardly, they're going to all agree and pat each other on the back.
Right, because nobody wants to be that one that, are taking up for the gay person because then are you gay? Are you down low?
Right.
Yeah, yeah. That was
I don't know.
Good scene.
I think they were strong scenes and maybe they could be a little excessive, but I agree with your statement. And that is, he was really trying to bring home the point of it. And if you can't, why soften it? I mean, these kids, clearly Buddy Lee and Ike both hated that their children were gay. They had arguments, didn't talk to them, like the whole thing.
They didn't go to their wedding.
They didn't go to their wedding. They really didn't hang out with their grandchild until they were gone.
Yep.
Yep. So I think those reactions are in line with someone who is fearful of what a homosexual, life is, what that life is. They're scared of it.
Yeah.
So they're going to react like... Mm-hmm. Kung Fu, get away from me.
Yes.
Swapping around. You know what I'm saying? It's like crazy.
Right. Yeah.
So I don't know. I didn't have too much of a problem with it.
I didn't either. I just felt like, this happens and this is what really happens. And especially, even though we're in 20, because this felt really present day. And I think that might be what people are thinking. The present day is still, it's 2021 or 2020 whenever he wrote this book. But it still exists. And in this state, in Virginia, it probably really is there's views on this is really strong. And I just felt like he had to hammer it and make a strong point by, it may have been like an over exaggeration to us, but I have a feeling, this man has seen this time and time again. And I felt like this was a very personal story. Especially I think about when we read Blacktop Wasteland, because he kind of threw some homophobic things out there in that book too, and that's when we had a did a guest show with another podcast team, and they were, you know, they kind of said those things were problematic. But now when I read this story, I'm like, it is problematic, but it's somebody's story.
Right.
And I think that's how I'm like trying to see this story, is I'm trying to see this story through the lenses of S.A. Cosby, and I'm beginning to appreciate him telling this story.
I mean, honestly, that's the only way I can get into any of his two books that we've read, is I have to remove myself from the equation completely.
Yes.
Because I don't talk like that. I don't move like that. I don't live in that type of environment.
Yep.
So I have to completely remove my own point of view from it and just try to take it as it is.
Yeah. And it's a ride. And that's how I felt too. Like, I've never read anything like this before. Never even thought to read, because like you said, I usually get books, you know, you kind of relate, have some kind of kindred, you know, ness with it. But this one, I felt like I got it after reading his first book. I felt like I get what he's doing here, and I appreciate hearing another side. And again, I'm going to say it, and I've said it probably in different podcasts before, this is why I love reading. This is how we learn about other cultures and other people's lives and stories. Because I've probably never, I don't know anybody from Virginia. I don't know these, you know, except for what we see in movies. But to hear this man write this story just, you know, open my eyes up to even more. So,
you know, I almost would say that this might be a good representation for a lot of rural areas, because, you know, if you live in a city or a suburb that's close to a city, it's more normal to have all types of people around you or to know someone in your circle that's different than you. But when you're in rural areas and everyone looks like you, everyone talks like you.
Ma'am, you better say that.
Yeah.
You better say it. Exactly.
So.
Exactly. Yeah. That was an excellent point. Yep. And I think by reading his story and then reading this, I have so much more of an appreciation for his writing. But this one, it was a hell of a ride, man. So we did that. And I was like, where else do we go from here? It's so much to unpack in this story. I enjoyed the development of the story, his world building. I mean, I knew about rural Virginia when I was done. I don't know what city that was.
I don't want to go there. That's all I know. I don't want to go there.
No, because you know what? There was plenty of sundown. That was a sundown town. Mm. Granted, the people lived there, but if we came through there, I mean, Buddy Lee showed up, what is that, the gas station or whatever, or the little pit stop, the little 7-Eleven with Ike at the, nigger was used. I'm sorry, the N-word was used often. And it's used often because it's used often in that city.
Yeah.
And like you said, I got to know rural Virginia, and I do not want to ever travel through that city.
I mean, on my way, I don't want to see a bunch of bikers either.
And I love that too. I love that part of it too. You know, the biker, I know somebody said it kind of reminded me of the Sons of Anarchy. Okay. I'm gonna go back really quick. That one little scene when Grayson got the call, and it was just like that quick look. I was like, what the hell? He just dropped a little nugget, and that just set off another spark in the story.
Yeah.
Loved it. Just loved it.
Okay. So actually, I think now's a great time for us to take a break. You guys check out the sponsors, listen to the commercials, head on over to Amazon and check out my book review journal. I have another one coming soon. It has a beautiful cover and the insides are a little different. Oh, yes. I'll be posting pictures soon when that comes. So definitely check it out. And when we come back, we'll finish talking about the plot. I'd like to talk about some plot holes.
Yes, ma'am.
The audiobook and more. Stay with us. Today's episode is brought to you by the Shelf Addiction Merch Store. Check out all the bookish t-shirts, notebooks, mugs, and more. Don't miss out on these original designs, perfect for any book nerd. Support the podcast and visit shelfaddiction.com/merch and pick up your next favorite bookish item. All right, welcome back, guys. Welcome back. So I'd love to talk about plot holes because I noticed a few.
Ooh, come on, bring them.
I mean, well, the main one that I think was like open but never resolved. And okay, so Tangerine is the character that I guess was, I guess, the catalyst for all of this. She told Isaiah and Derek something about her boyfriend, and then the boyfriend found out that they knew and sent people to kill them. So she, what? Okay. Tangerine says she loves her boyfriend so much. He loves me. He doesn't know what he's a part of. He is, you know, he's not the bad guy. He's just in over his head. I love him so much. He loves me. This is Tangerine's song and dance for 99% of the book. Then why, explain to me why she tells Isaiah and Derek, who works at a paper, about her boyfriend. Why does she do that? Like, what is her motivation? What did he do to her? What happened? Like, that bothers me. Like,
I thought he broke up with her. And I know she said she was drinking and she was emotional and she should have never said anything to them. But I thought he was trying to break up with her.
Oh,
I can't remember, but I think that was...
So two people died because you were angry that your boyfriend broke up with you? That is so stupid.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and I mean, because we haven't revealed, you know, the big shebang, but, you know, they died because her boyfriend was, you know, highly connected and, you know.
He was running for mayor again, right? Or governor, wasn't it?
I think it might have been governor. No, right, because he was a judge.
Mm-hmm.
He was a judge running for something. So yeah. So I think he was trying to break up with her, and she was emotional. And then, do we need to review?
Let's do it. Because to me, that is the stupidest
plot. Well, you know what? Thing. Maybe she has some brown liquor. Now, look. Come on now. Let's go there. Let's go there. Come on.
Okay.
Let's break it down.
I can hold my liquor.
Because you grown.
I'm not going to say anything.
Because you grown.
Yes, that's true. I'm 20-something years old. That's true.
Hey, Tangerine was what, 23? Was she? She was
something
young.
Around
she
there.
Was, yeah, I thought they said she was 23. Go ahead and reveal the circumstances behind all this and you know, and
so,
Tangerine.
Okay, so Derek's stepfather... So Derek's parents got divorced. She, I don't think they ever married. They were just together. They separated. She got married to this guy who was all in the church, holier than thou, blah, blah, blah. He's a judge. He hates that he's gay. He doesn't like him at all. He kicked him out. They pretty much disowned him because I can't be seen with a gay stepson. But this same guy is sleeping around on his wife and has a girlfriend, and that girlfriend is Tangerine, which for most of the good old boys, no problem. You got a side piece, but Tangerine is trans. She's a trans woman. And you know, he don't want that getting out at all.
Not at all. And he knew from the beginning.
Yes.
You know how it wasn't just a, Oh, I thought she was a woman. No, he knew from the start that she was a trans woman. And I knew something was up with Tangerine the way he kept writing about in the story how the pictures on the wall when they went to her house where she resembled the boy more than she resembled the mother. And I'm like,
right.
Something's going on here. It's LGBTQ. It's Tangerine. So, yes.
Yeah.
So, so she tells, you know, Derek and Isaiah, basically, my boyfriend about to break up with me. And he said he loved me, but he gonna break up with me, blah, 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 blah. Who's your boyfriend? I can't tell you who my boyfriend is. Three drinks later.
My boyfriend is ABC. And Derek's like, what?
What? That's my stepfather.
Right.
Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, she didn't want to tell. And she didn't want, she's like, just forget it. Because then all of a sudden it's, we're going to put this out in the store. And, you know, and was like, because he's a journalist. It's probably his big break. I'm about to blow the cover.
Yeah. And then he has reason to. Yeah, he had been, like I said, disowned, basically, mistreated, homeless. He was put out by this man who thinks that being a homosexual is wrong, quote unquote. But here you are, all up in this world going on with the community. Like, what's wrong with you? Yes. I'm going to tell on you and everyone's going to know who you are.
Yes. And that's when the shit hit the fan.
Yeah.
And she's like, oh.
Why would Tangerine say, well, I guess she wanted to warn him or off or something and warn him, hey, I told these two dudes, one guy works for the paper. I don't know if he's going to keep the secret.
Yeah. Yeah, because you know what? Because she loved, even though they were her friends, she loved this guy. Mm-hmm. And, she, you know, when you're young and dumb, all you think of is, you know, I want to protect him, even though they're my friends, but he loves me and he takes care of me. And I love him.
She is made out to be the most dumbest person ever, because when Buddy Lee and Ike start talking to her, they're like, girlfriend, has he ever taken a photo with you? Have you ever been anywhere outside of a hotel room? Has he ever taken you to the hotel room, or have you only met him there?
Right. I know. I was like, check.
Right.
I think the one quote was like, love doesn't hide. You don't hide who you love. And I was, and I will have to say this, I'm going to do a sidebar. There are so many quotes in this book, as you were saying, teachable lesson. There's so many great quotes in this book, but okay. Mm-hmm. But yes, he was, yeah, they broke it down and she was just like, no. Now, I mean, I don't think she said it in the book, but she's probably thinking in her head like, you know, no.
Yeah. She didn't even get the John Legend treatment. You know that song from his original CD where he's like singing about going and hanging out with his side piece in a city that no one has to know. They don't even go away and hold hands in a different state.
Nope.
She don't even get that.
Not even. Girl, but you did say the John Legend version.
You remember that song? Stealing moments just to be with you.
Yep. Now you're gonna make me go. Now you're gonna have me singing that damn song tonight.
No. Yeah. She don't have to know.
Mm-hmm. All she knew was
that song. Who knows about cheating?
Those are some of the best songs though. Okay.
Yeah.
They are, because, you know, the emotions are all out there on display, which, again, now that we say that, that's how she felt. And she probably felt like, here I am, a trans woman. And, you know, because he would tell her, you know, I think they showed her or she showed them some kind of letter like, see, he says it doesn't matter.
It was a text message. And Buddy Lee, like, he got game. Like, what is this? Like, that's a crazy. That's a text message.
But I mean, when you're like, again, when you're young and in love, and then she's a trans woman who has this person who accepts her, but she's blind. So, yeah. But yeah, those were some very funny scenes. I mean, funny, yeah. but serious.
And it was laid out for her. It was like she was in that bubble like you were talking about. And they came along and just poked holes all over that damn bubble. And she was like, he doesn't love me at all. Like, no, bitch, he doesn't.
No, because guess what? They're looking for you. He wants yeah. you dead. They not just that.
He's trying to kill you. And she's no, like, he's no.
not. No, he's not. Here comes the biker boys. Right.
He's trying to kill you. And then she's like, oh, man, it is him. He killed my mother, too. Like, yeah.
Gives no right. He cares more about himself and his image than he does about you, ma'am. Okay. All right. So now I'm curious. Plot hole number two, ma'am.
Oh, shoot. Let me find my notes.
Because I'm like, wait a minute.
Oh, okay. Now, this isn't a plot hole, but I guess I kind of have an issue with one of the plot twists.
Okay.
So the fact that Tangerine was trans kind of being used as a plot twist, I don't think that's really nice. I mean, I don't know how to say it. It just seems like, damn, I don't know. It just feels wrong to use that as the plot twist. Like, the fact that she was trans. Like, why can't it just be, like, I don't know. Like, the affair was the plot twist. But, you know what I'm saying? I'm having a hard time expressing myself. But I'm like, that's so... then icky, like, why does that have to be? It felt icky, like that is the plot twist. I just felt like right. there could have been another way to accomplish that without, you know, because then they had to go into this whole thing, you know, she was injured when, you know, they were attacked by the bikers. They go and Ike's help wife helps with that injury, and she comes out and she's like, hey, let me talk to you. And then she right. relays that she's trans and she needs a safe place to go.
Right.
And Buddy Lee's all like, but wait a minute. I don't understand. She got boy parts, right? I'm like, oh my God. And she like,
Ix girl.
I'm like, oh. And then they had to go all into it. And then, of course, the wife had to explain she presents as a woman. She wants to be a woman. So we're going to, out of respect, we are going to call her what she wants to be called.
Yep. Again, like, another teachable moment because they don't know.
I know. But I'm like, yeah. dang. Like, I mean, I just wish there was
a
way.
But this is the thing with the plot hole with that. Even because we already knew it was an affair.
Uh-huh.
So you're saying, should it just had been an affair and we didn't have to use a trans woman? Or he didn't have to use a trans woman.
Yeah, but I guess maybe he just wanted to fit in all the different aspects of the LGBTQ
right, community
thing. I mean, did you check all the boxes? I kind of felt it was a little like that. Mm. A little. Mm. I'm like, couldn't it just... It could have just been a friend.
Yeah,
and it would have been the same results.
Exactly. You're right, regardless. Because now he's... because he is a Christian Bible-toting...
Right.
Politician who doesn't believe in. Right.
Right. And we know politicians, they get burned bad when they get outed for affairs.
True.
Straight,
I get you.
Cis relationships, cis women, whatever, they get outed and it's their career's over for affairs.
Yep.
So
somebody say
that
Wiener?
One, I'm sorry. That one extra layer was just like, I mean, yeah. it just felt so token, for lack of a better word.
I got you. Yep. It could have just been a simple, it could have just, right, could have been just a cis woman who was a friend of the couple who just happened to tell them and they wanted to expose old Winthrop. So, yeah.
Right.
I get it.
The same effect. He's cheating on my mom. I'm outing him. Same effect.
Yep. Yep. Got it. Okay.
So, I don't know. That just bothered me a little bit.
Gotcha. I see there. I see that. Yeah, I mean, because when we want to go, you know, check in if you're on, and we did check some other authors about their diverse and Black person check. Mm-hmm. So let's get on essay about He checked every. He was trying to go L, G, B, Q. He was checking every alphabet. Right. He was trying.
Right.
And he, yeah. Yeah, you're right. Okay. I get that one.
Yeah.
Get that
so,
one.
So, I mean, that's it. I mean, I just, you know, when I read, I just can't be like, everything's great. I'd be like,
no. No, I found some things I didn't like too. So
really,
yeah,
hit me with one of them, so I don't feel like I'm the only one going in on the book.
And you know what? He did it in the last book. When it comes to him describe him and women,
mm-hmm.
and of biracial women, he goes all out.
Yep,
he goes full throttle when describing them. But his wife Maya.
Mm-hmm.
She had braids. She was, I can't even remember, but, you know, his granddaughter was, you know, blah, 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 and her curly hair and blah, blah, blah. Tangerine was biracial. Yep. You know, all, you know, he goes full description, but he's very bland when it comes to Black female characters. And I think we said even with Blacktop Wasteland, this is something about with him that's a personal thing. And I think we even were like, does he have biracial children? And I mean, that's fine. But if you're going to have a character with a Black woman or any Black woman in your book, they need to have the same measure of description as your other characters.
Right.
Maya was bland.
Yes.
Very bland. Margot, I knew more about Margot and what she looked like than I know about Maya.
Mm.
That's how I felt. You know, Margot had the long hair. She was kind of like a hippie kind of, you know, whatever. Maya, I knew she was a nurse, and she had braids, and they had to cut it because, you know, of her surgery because she had an accident. But Maya was not fully, she wasn't flushed out.
No.
And another one of my things, too, his female characters weren't flushed out enough. You know, like, we knew she was trans and she loved, but her character wasn't flushed out, I think, enough. For this story, for her to be the catalyst. Mm-hmm. Granted, you know, I just felt like those were some of my issues with him, his description of the balance of his description of biracial characters versus, you know, African-American characters, and not fleshing out his female characters. He did that with Blacktop Wasteland. That wife was a strong character, but she could have had some more layers. She was, you know, she wasn't three dimensional. You know, she was very flat. So those are my issues with Mr. S.A. Cosby. And his character development and writing style of his characters.
Yeah, definitely. I would have loved to know more about Tangerine. I agree with you. And actually, that makes me wonder, do you think that Derek and Isaiah were developed enough, even though they were never on the page?
Hmm.
Like, we knew they were gay. We knew they got married. We knew they had a child somehow. And we knew their parents were very angry about it. Well, the fathers.
I think they were. We knew college educated. We knew Derek loved to cook as a child. He went to, you know, he became a chef. Even though the father, Ike, tried to, you know, kind of sway him into doing more manly things, Derek didn't. He was, I'm not like you, Dad.
Which in the end, he's like, now I got a granddaughter. I'm going to teach her to box.
I didn't sign up. It's like, you don't get it. But I mean, she, you know, hopefully once he realizes if she doesn't want to do it, he'll stop. But
yeah.
I'm trying to think. I think they tried to, you know, show us Derek and Ike through other characters. Like, we saw Derek and Ike through the eyes of the mothers and through the fathers. And I would say Derek, we got a little glimpse of him through the eye of, well, The judge didn't really talk about Isaiah, but we got to see how the judge felt about Isaiah. So I don't know. I mean,
even Derek's mother was bland about her own child. I mean, she felt bad about the stuff that went down, but I didn't feel like there was any kind of connection. Like Mia, was that the mother's, Ike's Maya. Wife's name? Maya. Mm-hmm. She felt.
Oh, wait. Yeah. The black mother. Yes. Maya.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I felt she had a real good connection with her son. And that mm-hmm. was evident when she got tricked. And it was clear it was a setup, but she didn't care. She wanted to get what she could of her son out of her house before right. it burned down.
Yeah.
It was a pictures, clear bait
baby
switch,
shoes. Yeah.
But she didn't care. Like I felt that connection between the two of them. And I didn't get it with Derek and his mother.
No, she didn't. All she cared about was herself and her image and her husband's image. And definitely.
Speaking of which, when Buddy Lee comes to like crash into their house and he's like, he killed our son. She like, Buddy Lee, stop. I'm like, you dummy.
Like, I wouldn't have been like Buddy Lee. I would have turned around and said,
What
is he talking about? Right. His name was, you know, I'd been like, what is he talking about? Excuse me?
Right. She didn't even ask, what do you mean he killed our son? She like, who is Tangerine? Bitch, which is more important right now? Who is Tangerine or did you kill my son?
Thank you. We'll talk about Tangerine later. Right now,
right.
My baby 6 feet under.
Right.
Yeah. Even after he was dead, she didn't have the kind of regret that Ike and Buddy Lee felt. Mm-hmm. She had none of that. It was just, I kind of felt bad for him getting kicked out and blah, blah. Mm-mm.
But she was like, it's like she really wanted to believe that picket white fence she had. She wanted to believe that whole, you know, ultra conservative Christian, whatever.
Yes.
And she is like, if I don't, I have to be with my husband. I got to believe in my husband. I'm like, girl.
They're a dime a dozen.
Right.
They're a dime a dozen.
Right.
And now look.
Yes.
They're a dime a dozen, honey. Mm. And I get that, you know, when you get older, your children can leave you and won't take care of you. But I'm sorry. And I think that was, you know, a big theme in this book, that regardless, your children are either your children. If we even just take out duality out of the equation when it comes to loving your children, let's just go with they didn't live up to, I wanted him to be a doctor. You know, our children are going to be who they are. We can't make them be what we want them to be. You know, mm-hmm. if you think about, you know, your mother probably had dreams for you. I wish she would be blah, 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 but you can't, you know, you wind up choosing a different path, but it should not matter what path you choose. You are my child. You are flesh of my flesh. You know, bone of my bone. It does not matter that you didn't choose or you're not living up to whatever standard that society has placed on. Yeah.
Right.
And, you know, and those are all, some of them are all man-made anyway. We have no set, you know, rules in this universe. This is what it's supposed to be. But anywho, I can go on and on about that.
That is a testament to good parents, because even if my parents wanted me to be A and I end up being D or whatever, they didn't have to tell me, oh, you're such a disappointment, you never became an A. You know, they kept that stuff to themselves.
Yes.
Like,
yep.
You know,
right? Because in the end, all you want from me as a parent, I'll just speak for myself, all I want is my kids to be happy and to live a productive life according to what they want.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're happy, I'm happy. If you know, you're not committing crimes and you're living the best life that you can, so be it.
Yeah.
Because not everybody is meant, you know, my vision for you is my vision. But in the end, I've told my kids that my goal for them, I feel like I'm a personal assistant. I'm here to help you be the best who you can be. Okay, you don't want to be that? Okay, let's go try fine. This one. I'm here to help you and help you and help guide you regardless. Yep. But in the end,
I feel I like do you what you want, be who you want, do what you want to do. As long as you're not hurting anybody else by doing that, do whatever.
Amen. Amen. That's what it breaks down. That's how we just hope and pray.
Yeah.
People will come to that conclusion. But yeah, this is, it's just so many nuggets in this book. So
maybe we should go around and hand out copies of this on World Book Day to people that live in rural areas and may be racist and homophobic. Okay, that might have sounded really bad coming out my mouth, but I meant it in a good way.
Yeah, because it did. It spoke on so many the themes in here. It was, race, sex, class, status, all those different things he touched upon in this book. And, a lot of times we just kind of think it's the homosexuality, but it was just so many topics, like even Buddy Lee tried to tell you live better than I do. I'd love to, be in your shoes. And Ike was like, really? Would you really like to live in the black man's shoes?
Yeah. He's like, I'd like to trade cars with you. He's like, oh, you can have a car, but this is what you get with the car.
How about getting pulled over, sir? Yeah. Yeah, because, Buddy Lee was like, well, you're a black man with a business, which is, again, a lot of views of white people. Oh, you're a successful black person. So you beat the odds. No, I don't.
Yeah.
No, I don't. I'm still black. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, he touched on just so many, deep rooted views of all those, those different themes. But I did also like how he did the similarities and the differences between like Buddy Lee and Ike, again, with they both served jail time. They both had gay sons. They both were hypersexual males. But then the differences of, how Buddy Lee tried to act like, you have privilege and I don't. I'm, white trash, but you have privilege because you have this, business and this nice car and I live in a trailer. And he, again, like we just discussed, but you're still a white man. You don't get the same type of attacks that I get. So, he did some really good writing and touching those different subjects in a way that wasn't like just hammered over your head, but it was just kind of like,
noted. Check. Mm-hmm. That's what he said.
Sorry,
it is
dude.
What it is.
Yep. This is my life.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what were some of your favorite moments in the book?
Honestly, I think, I'd have to say it was the dialogue between Buddy Lee and Ike. It really was like those moments when they were alone and those moments where Buddy Lee was realizing, Ike had skills in certain areas and he just, even though he knew he was a killer, I think he underestimated him. And there were a few times that Ike surprised him, like, dang, I'm glad you're on my side kind of surprise.
Mm-hmm.
And it's
right.
Like
the fertilizer scene, girl.
Yeah. And even like at the end, Ike was saying, Buddy Lee is my friend. He was like, where is my wife and my friend? He's like, oh, damn, did I just call him my friend?
Exactly.
That happened like a couple times. He's like, well, I guess he may be my friend. I don't know.
Yes. Yeah, I've been on this journey.
You murder together, you're friends.
Yeah, you're definitely friends. I'm sorry.
You're friends. Yeah.
You guys put a person in a wood chipper.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean,
I'm sorry.
Ike saved Buddy from death when they were in their son's house. That guy was going to get him. And then he snuck up like a ninja and knocked his ass out. Like, dang. Mm-hmm.
With a toilet lid.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's when they had like just started their, it wasn't even a friendship yet. It was, we're going to try and figure this out. Okay. Yeah. I don't know you real well, dude, but okay, we'll go to our kid's house and look for stuff. So yeah.
Yeah, those scenes with them together interacting were the best. And some of those action scenes were comedic, over the top, but comedic.
Right. It was fun. They were, you know, like the perfect odd couple.
Yeah.
They were the perfect odd couple. And I know I've read another review where somebody was saying they struggled with the book because they felt like the things that Buddy Lee was saying, listen to this. The things that Buddy Lee was saying probably should have been coming out of Ike's mouth. And it was because, you know, he was using slang and term that Black people use. And I beg to differ, because in those rural countries like that, it's vice versa. It's not just Black people. The thing is that as a Black person, and I believe this reviewer was a Black person, we're just used to us saying it because you're around Black people. But the country folks use that term. They yeah. use those terms. We're just so used to it because, you know, you and I, as Black women, we hang out and this is, you know, how we use it in the country like that. That's you. That's, I'll just give you another example. Like, I didn't realize like white people liked collard greens. Mm-hmm. And then my grandmother was like, do you realize in the South that we cooked for them? So yeah. they grew up on collard greens and grits. And I was like, oh, yeah. So, you know, I was just like, she doesn't get it. She doesn't understand that. That's just yeah. the language that they speak down there. She was like, I was confused because, you know, the things that Buddy Lee was saying, that's something a Black man should be saying. So, I was like, see. So you got to tell me, S.A. Cosby, who grew up in Virginia, who lives there, doesn't know the lingo?
That tells me she's only around a certain type of people.
And that's why you need to read more, my friend. Yeah. That's why you need to read more. Again, shall I say it again? This is why I love reading. This is why I love book club.
Take note, people. Take note.
You know, my eyes have been so open so much from just yeah. reading. You know, that's all I got to say. There's just so many. Just read a damn book.
Yeah, read a book or read two a or book. Three. Read a
man, the things you will learn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yes. All right. We are on an hour. Let's talk about the narrator real fast and then we'll rate it.
Okay.
So the narrator, you guys, I mentioned earlier that the book was only 336 pages, but the audio was 12 hours.
Why and was it 12 hours?
Because his ass was talking in slow motion like this. I had to speed him up to like, most of it I listened at 1.8, but I probably could have listened on 2.
Yeah. And he narrated the last book too. And when yeah. I saw it was him, I was like, oh, shit.
We sped it up too that time.
Adam Lazar.
He has a great voice. And honestly, when you speed it up, he still sounds great. He sounds yeah. like how he should sound.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm like, good Lord, man.
I mean.
Dragging ass, man. Gosh. Like,
just because you're Southern, unless he was trying real hard to enunciate and stuff, so that slowed his pace down, maybe? I don't know. But I'm like, there is no reason for this thing to be 12 hours. This should have been 9 hours, 8 hours, 8.5 hours.
Because when you said 12 hours, I was like, really didn't feel yeah. like 12 hours, but that's again, I sped it up.
Right.
12 hours? Didn't feel like 12 hours to me. Well, I guess not at 1.8, yeah.
No. Nope.
No. And that was probably my only issue was he's slow as hell.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, can I go back really quick on and say one thing before we move on to like cover art and rating?
Sure.
Because I love finding the title of the book in the story, like if the author kind of tells it. So I found two quotes. Mm-hmm. One was, tears ran from his eyes and stung his cheek. This is at the beginning. Tears for his son, tears for his wife, tears for the little girl they had to raise. tears for who they were and what they had lost. Each drop felt like it was slicing his face open like a razor blade. And then the last quote of the book, the tears came again. They poured from his eyes and ran over his cheeks, flowed down to the stubble on his chin. This time, they didn't feel like razor blade tears. They felt like the long-awaited answer to a mournful prayer for rain.
I was like, oh, he's learned and grown so much.
Yes. So, yeah, I always love, that's one of my little things, is to find out, okay, why did you choose this title?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That really was a small thing, but a big thing at the same time. It was only mentioned twice, at the beginning and the end.
Mm-hmm.
And it shows we started here and we ended there.
Yep. I was like, look at you.
Yeah.
And another thing, this is getting optioned as a movie. Not sure if it's going to be in theater or streaming, but...
Well, I know one thing. It better not show up anywhere but HBO or Netflix, because everyone else will not, they will tiptoe around it.
I know you're going to say it better not be on Amazon.
No, it better not be on Amazon or Hulu, really. Yeah. I mean, Hulu pushed it a little bit with The Handmaid's Tale, but...
Little.
Right. But they, like, to get into the gore level, it needs to be like...
No,
we're talking HBO level of gore.
Yep. The screenwriter is Sherman Payne, who did Shameless, and the producer Jerry Bruckheimer. So
Shameless was on a paid cable channel, wasn't it? Showtime or something.
And they didn't hold they were so excited about that.
Yeah. So alrighty. Cover art. You like the cover art?
It was simple. It wasn't like over the top, but you have the two guys walking down the path. So I'm assuming that might be like the path after. I don't know exactly where the path, but it's rural. But I thought that it was perfect. It was simple. It didn't give away too much.
Buddy Lee and Ike walking down a dirt road.
Mm-hmm. Yep. How about you?
Point blank. Yeah, I liked it. It's simple. Honestly, if I saw this on the shelf, I would walk by it.
Yeah, exactly.
If I didn't already know this author, I would have walked right by it.
Yep. Yeah, because when you think razor blade tears and two people walking down a dirt path, you're like,
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I've been like, oh, there's some sad ass weepy shit in the South. That's what I would have thought and walked right by it.
Right, because I never even heard razor blade tears. I wouldn't know that terminology at all. No. So, yeah. But yeah, I mean, now that, like you said, we know the author and. But yeah, I would have passed by it as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yep.
All right. Let's rate the thing. Let's rate the book. That's the last thing we do. Okay, how about you kick it off, Classy? You go first.
You make me kick it off, you guys.
Yes.
So I really, really, really wanted to give him 5 stars for this because it's an excellent book. But my issues with him and his characters made me drop it. And he did everything he needed to do. But dude, if you're gonna give biracial women beautiful descriptions as a Black woman, we need equal representation. We need equal. So yes. 4 stars.
So I was surprised I rated this the same as you, because the last book I think I rated it 3. I think his last book was a 3 for me. So I gave it 4. I did have issues. The things I liked that it was movie script ready. It read like a movie script.
Girl.
Fast pace, action. You could see these scenes in front of you. He gets points for that. He gets points for it being fast. He gets points for the entertainment value.
Yeah.
But he gets deductions for, like, you know, I had a problem with the trans person being a plot twist.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't think some of the stuff was necessary, I guess. I don't know. It was a barrage of like homophobic things and sexist and racist things. But you know, that was the essence of the book in itself. So it's almost counterintuitive the way I think right. about it.
Yeah. But because that was the whole point of it. You know, it was hard and in your face.
Yeah.
But he was trying to get a point across. But I get it.
Right. So for that, I will give it a 4. And, you know, I got through it pretty quickly. And I did have to set my mind to read this book because I know how he writes. He writes, he's gritty, he's hard. And we're coming off of, and no, I don't mean this any kind of way, but female writers write different from male writers. They do.
Yep.
The tone is different. The delivery is different. Everything he does is like hammer to nail in the book, you know? There's no finessing.
There wasn't any lull. There really wasn't any like really lull moments because it was like, okay, but I'm leading you up to, and you know it. You know the crescendo is coming.
Yeah, and most things, I mean, yeah, it could have been done with a little more precision instead of a sledgehammer, but that's how he writes.
It was crime fiction.
Right.
I mean, granted, in Goodreads, it called, you know, like the majority of the tags were mystery thriller and then crime fiction. But this is straight up crime fiction, babe. This is crime fiction. And he doesn't hold any punches. But yeah.
No.
So 4 stars. I mean, and those are just some personal issues that I have as a reader. So.
Yeah. Same. But we're on the upper side of good. So he didn't fall in the between this time. He got on the other side.
yes. I'm looking forward to the movie.
Yeah, me too. I'm curious to see who, you know, what studio picks it up, and if it ends up like with like A-list celebrities and it goes to the theater, or if it ends up, you know, just straight to TV. Because now they do so much straight to, you know, straight to HBO or straight to Netflix, all that.
Yeah. And some of those are really good. The productions are well, you know, well written and well done. So.
Yeah, it's just the new era of things, you know.
Yeah.
Because people weren't going to the movies, blah, blah, blah. We know the deal. Mm-hmm. So they did a lot of that in the last 2 years. And so now I think they realize they can still make money off of this stuff and it doesn't have to go to the theater. So, just depends.
Yeah.
All right, you guys. So join us over on Facebook in Shelf Addiction Official, or hit us up on the Book Clubs app. And now it is with an S, Book Clubs, spelled properly.
Did they change it?
They changed it.
Really?
So it was Book Clubs with a Z, and then in January they changed it to Book Clubs with an S because they thought it should be spelled correctly as they're about books.
Wow.
So yes.
Okay.
And I was like, what? I'm like, you changed it? And I've been saying it in my podcast the whole time with a Z?
Yeah.
And now it's with an S?
Right, because I saw your newsletter and I was like, oh, wait, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
They changed it. So that's that. Find us there and we can talk about this book or we can talk about other things. And speaking of other things, our next book, if you want to pick it up, you know, before you hear the next podcast episode, we are reading Ace of Spades. And I do not know how to say her name. So her name is Farada Abiki Imadid, I think.
No, we have to practice that.
Girl, I
have to watch some YouTube videos.
I need to listen. I need to hear how the narrator says it, but I did not download the book yet. So Farida, I think it's right. Farida. And then you can find her by doing Ace of Spades, typing in her first name. It will come right up. Girl,
yeah
that last name got a lot of little things on
it's an African last name. I believe she's African, so yes. Excited because that's something. It's a YA, right?
It is. We are returning to YA after a long stint away. So
It's been a while since we did a YA.
Yeah, it has been. So the reviews are pretty good. It's been out for about 7 months now. The reviews are still hitting.
Oh, good.
Like 4.31 average.
After 7 months?
Yeah, after 7 months. So I'm hoping and praying because we could use another good book. I feel like we've had, you know, this one was a good one. I want another good one.
Yes, please. Come on, 2021.
Yes, or 2022.
Oh my gosh. Come on, Classy. 2022.
You're only a year behind. No problem.
Yes, just a couple of months. That's it.
Yeah. All right, y'all. So that is it for today. Do you have anything else before we sign off, Classy?
I don't. I am complete.
Okay, wonderful. We hope you enjoyed the conversation today. Hit us up on social media. You know where to find us. And until next time, happy reading. Take care of yourselves. Bye, guys. If you enjoyed today's episode and would like to show your support, there are a few things you can do. Head on over to Apple Podcasts and leave a positive 5-star review or like this episode on your favorite podcast player. It seems so simple, but it really helps me out. You can share this podcast with other book nerd friends or on your favorite social media space. You can also join the Shelf Addiction Patreon family. For as little as $2 a month, you will help us produce even more awesome content for your ears. You can also consider joining the Shelf Addiction Official Facebook group where we talk all things bookish and more in a safe space. The Shelf Addiction Podcast is a part of the Nerdy Maven Network. You can also reach us via email at info@shelfaddiction.com. Thank you for listening.